So today in numerical methods, I start a section on the Monte Carlo method. Actually, I like the Monte Carlo method very much, yeah, because it is very versatile, very flexible, very powerful. And also quite important, yeah, since we like to implement the stuff, it is also quite simple. But on a first look, yeah, if you look onto the method, what we will see today, it's a bit, little bit suspicious. So actually it looks not so useful because the convergence results so it is a method to approximate something. It converges to a solution. And this convergence result holds only in a probabilistic sense. Okay. So actually this means that we cannot be sure that we have found the solution. This sounds a bit useless. Yeah? So, however, as I will show you later, this probabilistic nature is not an issue. It's not a bug. It's a feature. So, the probabilistic feature is the probabilistic nature is rather a feature than a bug, because it will enable us to achieve something which is actually not possible, or say a little bit more difficult with non-probabilistic methods. And in the end, we will see when we do quasi-random number generation that actually we can also get rid of this probabilistic nature to some extent. So I start with a motivation. Okay, introducing the method. And so in our application, mathematical finance, but also in many other applications, yeah, we are confronted with the need to calculate an expectation. So an expectation of a random variable. And now let's consider the case of a discrete random variable. Yeah, so over a space with finitely many events. Then you know that the expectation of this random variable is just a weighted sum. So the values that the random variable can take multiplied with the probability that the corresponding event occurs. Yeah? So the value that the random variable takes for a given event multiplied with the probability that this event occurs, summed up over all events, since the sum of the probability is equal to 1, over all events, this is a weighted average. And now I will do something quite stupid. I mean, this is a very simple, very efficient formula on calculating the expectation. So I will introduce a somewhat stupid, inefficient method of approximating this probability. Yeah. So here, let us consider a somewhat stupid or inefficient. Inefficient way to approximate or to calculate the probability. Okay, so how do I like to do this? Well, assume we have some method to randomly draw from omega. So consider a sequence of drawings. Yeah, so the word drawings will appear later again. So now maybe you just have an intuition that we have drawings of this. So this sequence of drawings should be xk. Yeah, so drawings xk from omega. And these should be done according to the probability p. So what does this mean? So this means in the sequence x1, x2, x3, in this sequence, an event occurs exactly corresponding to the probability in the limit. So that is, if we take the sum over, say, for example, an indicator function, yeah, so we have now x1 to x capital M, yeah, so we have capital M drawings, and this is such that if we take the average of, say now, okay, I have to take a different index, k from 1 to m, indicator function is xk equal to omega j. So I just count how often did I hit omega j in my drawing, divided by the total number of drawings. So this should converge to the probability. Of omega j, sorry. When I make many, many drawings. So if m goes to infinity. Okay, so actually you already maybe see that we have to take many, many drawings to have a nice convergence here. So let's consider an example. Yeah, so example. I have a dice, yeah, so n is 6, omega is just the 6 faces of my cube, my dice, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The probability of every event is the same, okay, 1 over 6. Then for xk, we do some drawing. Yeah, so here's a drawing xk. Say it is 1, 3, 5, 6, 1, maybe also a 2, maybe a 4, 3, and so on. And then if you like to know the probability that we have hit a 3, yeah, you just count 0 plus 1 plus 0, 0, 0, 0, and so on. Okay. We could have a small code that does this. Okay. So this is a small piece of code that would do this. I would like to take a sum from I from 0 to number of samples, this would be our m. Then I would like to generate a drawing from 1 to 6. So we will discuss this later, how this is done. Yeah. So Currently, it is a black box. There is a function which gives us a uniform distributed drawing. So this number is between 0 and 1, 1 not included. So if I multiply it with 6, it's between 0 and 6, 6 not included. Adding 1, it's between 1 and 7, 7 not included. If I take the integer, it is the number 1 to 6. Yeah? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then I calculate the indicator function. For example, is this drawing equal to 3? Yes, then the indicator is 1, otherwise it's 0. Then we calculate the sum. Yeah, we sum up all those indicators. We calculate the average. Since we started in 0, the first one has I equals 0, so I have to divide by I plus 1. And then I store this in some list here, so I have a list of all the averages. I store it and we can print it. So if I run this, I can also plot it. I have a small code that plots this. And you see, this is the picture. So when it spikes up, there's a 1. And otherwise, I just divide by larger and larger numbers. And you can also look here. Yeah. So the first one was a 5. The second one was a 3. There's the indicator. And we are counting this. This is 1 divided by 2. And then there are many zeros until position 11 here. Yeah, so we're counting it. Okay, so that would be a method to say somehow approximate the probability, so the green part of this sum here. And if you would plot, for example, this indicator function, this running average over the indicator function for different sequences, you would get different lines here. Yeah? So the red one is first 0. Yeah? Then the second one appears to be a 1 because it jumps up here. Then it's a 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. Two ones, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, and so on. Yeah, and the green one is first 0, and then it jumps here. It has a 1 here. Yeah, so this is actually position 5, and so on. And you see it somewhat converges to 0.1666. Yeah, so 1/6. Yeah, so it converges to. The probability. Okay, so now if we have this, say, way of approximating the probability, then we can maybe use it in our formula to calculate the expectation. Yeah. So our task was to calculate the expectation of a random variable z. And we know that the expectation of a random variable is the weighted average of the value of z at an event multiplied with the probability that this event occurs. Okay, so maybe I have a little bit more space. Space here, move it down. So, okay, so now plug this guy. Plug this guy here into this formula. So that would be the sum over all events z of omega j. Multiplied with 1 divided by m. So this is now my approximation for the probability. Yeah? 1 divided by m, the sum over all k. So in my sequence, and then the indicator function is xk equal to omega j. Okay, so then I have that. So this is a finite sum. Yeah? Then I have that. This guy on the right-hand side converges for m to infinity, actually to my expectation. Okay, so let's continue calculating with this double sum. So I have the sum over all events, the value of my random variable, now multiplied with this sum over the indicator functions. Indicator function, my sequence approximating the probability, or my drawing from the events. Yeah. So the sum over the indicator functions, the moving average is approximating the probability. So my sequence drawn from my events and the indicator is this equal to omega j. So now we can flip the sums. Okay. Oops. So flips the sums. What has happened here? So this means I have 1 divided by m, the sum k from 1 to m, and then we have the sum over all j from 1 to n, z of omega j multiplied with the indicator function xk equals omega j. Okay, and now we can observe that here in this sum there is an indicator function. So this is the sum over j. We are going through all possible omega j. Xk has one value, one omega j. So this is one only for a single value, namely for the value that is in Xk. So actually this is z of omega j where Xk is equal omega j. Yeah, for that omega j where zk is equal to omega j. So actually this is equal to z of xk. Okay, so that is our approximation is 1 divided by m, k from 1 to m, z of xk. Okay, so now I have that this sum, 1 divided by m, the sum over all k, z of xk, where xk is a random drawing from my events with the property that the drawing is made such that it's according to corresponds to the probability, then this converges to the expectation. Okay, so here are this is the derivation, written maybe a little bit nicer. And now I have that this sum here converges to the expectation of that for m going to infinity. Okay, so when we started actually calculating the expectation using this sum over I from 1 to n had two parts. Yeah, one was the probability part and one was the evaluation, the evaluation of the random variable. So that part. So where are these two parts on the left-hand side? So actually on the left-hand side, the knowledge about the probability is now inside xk. Yeah, so it's inside xk. And we just evaluate z on this sequence. So just repeatedly evaluate z for a given number of events. So actually the sum on the left-hand side, yeah, which is the Monte Carlo approximation of the expectation, really looks very inefficient. Because, for example, think that our dice is not fair and the number three occurs with a higher probability, so twice as often, yeah? So 1/3. And on the other one occur correspondingly less often. Then on the right-hand side, this is taken into account by having here a higher weight of the probability. So you have a higher weight here, so you have 1/3 instead of 1/6. How is this achieved on the left-hand side? On the left-hand side, it's that the number three occurs more often in the xk. Yeah? So I'm calculating more often the same value. Okay, this sounds inefficient, yeah? I calculate more often the same value, then I calculate values that are rare. And also for our dice, n is equal to 6, while in my computer experiment I already used m equal to 100 and the convergence was visible, but maybe not already sufficient. Okay, so that's the main idea. Let's summarize a little bit. So probability is here by generating xk according to p. Okay, so and then we evaluate z on the given sequence. Okay, so this looks stupid. This looks inefficient. So, but now let's take a look at it again. So first, there's one advantage. The sum on the left somehow separates generation of the model. So how is the stuff distributed? What is the probability from the evaluation function z? Yeah. So this is later nice for the implementation. Yeah. So let's take here separates modeling of P from evaluation of Z. And also, we started with an example where n is a small number, and actually we know the probability for every event. Actually in the computer code where we looked at, so here in this code, we actually have to know the probability at this point where we construct the drawing. Yeah? But in our example, n was a very small number, 6. But now consider an example where n is a very, very large number, much larger than m. So if n is very large, say much larger than sufficient, yeah, so we have to discuss later what is sufficient. Then this is a useful thing here. Then this is useful. Okay, because on the left-hand side, I just have to evaluate z m times, and I get an approximation to the expectation. While on the right-hand side, the true expectation, I have to calculate the expression for every possible event. So when there are many events, then the left-hand side is maybe a nice expression. And now what looked as if it was a disadvantage, yeah, so I mentioned that if you have a point that has a higher probability, then it appears in the left-hand sum more often. So you are more often calculating the same thing again. Actually, now this becomes a feature because since X, the sequence, is generated according to the probability P, it means that more important points appear more likely in this sequence. So you are very likely taking the values of Z which are important for the sum. Yeah? So see here, in this sum, a point that is not important gets a small probability. So it gets a small contribution to the sum. So actually, if you just are interested in an approximation, you can drop this one. Okay, and this is somehow automatic on the left-hand side. Important values occur. So I could say in this example where 3 occurred more often, occurs more often. Here, if we just do not evaluate all the possible events, important points occur more likely. Yeah. So actually this is a nice approximation. It automatically takes the points which are important because xk is sampled such, and if n is very large, it may be more efficient to just take m samples to get this approximation. Okay, so here's a small summary. So the expression on the left-hand side, our Monte Carlo approximation, may serve as an approximation for the expectation of z. And the number required to calculate this, so the number of calculations m required to achieve a certain level of approximation, is possibly much lower than n. Okay, and the second remark is that the generation of xk, which is the modeling of the probabilities, yeah, so the modeling of xk is separated from the calculation of the random variable. Okay, so later this will be in an implementation, for example, the separation of the modeling of a financial model and the evaluation of a financial product. A financial product tells you what happens in a certain event, and the model tells you how likely it is that a certain event happens. So these parts are now separated. So I started with an example on a finite dimensional space. Yeah. So with a very small n. Of course, all this can be done on a continuous space. Yeah, for continuous random variables. So we can formulate this result for a continuous random variable. Yeah. So we will see this later using the strong law of large numbers. So this means my finite sum here, Z of omega I, the probability of the event omega I, is replaced by an integral over all events Z of omega dp omega. Yeah? And now you see here n is effectively infinity. Yeah? And now we have an approximation still using a finite sum. Okay? So we will have that our finite sum over Z of xk converges to the expectation of that even for this continuous case. Okay, so when I started, let's go back here, I mentioned the word drawings. So xk is a sequence being drawings from omega. And here in this picture, you see the red line, for example, these are different. These are sums, yeah? So sums of the indicator function. And the xk's are word drawings, yeah, from our set 1 to 6. So, but now later, later today or later in the session, we will look at certain convergence results and how is actually a drawing modeled? So maybe you still know this, yeah? But I like to repeat this maybe here. So a drawing corresponds to a sequence of IID random variables having the same distribution as the original random variable. So this is how we model a drawing. So let me write this down. So when I like to have a drawing of say n events, then I construct a product space. So we have omega tilde. Omega tilde is now the Cartesian product of my space omega of possible events. Okay. So the product from I from 1 to n over omega. And on that space, I define a probability, and this is where the independence comes in. Yeah, so this is now a probability from omega tilde, my product space, to R. And the probability is such that P tilde of a product of sets, so AI, each AI being a subset of omega. This is just the product of the probabilities on the original space. So the P of AI. So the independent events are independent, say, dimensions in this product space. Okay. And now if we have a random variable, so here we have a random variable x, I'm considering independent drawings. That is, I consider a random variable x tilde on this product space. So, oops, sorry. This should be a double dot. So now I consider a random variable x tilde on this product space, where x tilde of omega So now this little omega, I should maybe call it omega tilde. Yeah. So this little omega is from omega tilde. So it is from the product space. It is a vector of events, each from omega. And this new random variable is just the random variable x of omega 1 x of omega n. So this is what we have here. I'm defining x tilde such that the ice component of x tilde on a single event is x at the event omega I. Okay, so there is one remark here. So this means that a drawing of n events, so these are n samples, n independent samples of my random variable x. Yeah, so independent because omega I doesn't know anything about omega k for I not equal k. Yeah. So these are my drawings. They are actually modeled as one event on omega tilde. Okay. So if you go back to our little picture, then here, actually, I could say that the whole red line is one omega tilde. Okay. And the green line is another omega tilde. Okay. These were 100 drawings, but the drawings is like one event from the product space, from the 100 dimensional product space. And independence is created by having the probability being such as this, okay? So this is actually a remark. So I believe actually you should know this, but it's important for us because when you go back to the picture, you see convergence somehow, yeah? So the red line somehow converges to the blue line. But if this convergence will be in a probabilistic sense, then actually omega tilde is just a null set, yeah? So, or it could be a null set. So it could be that we have no guarantee that actually this converges. Okay, so that was maybe an important remark that you understand what does it mean to have a drawing. Yeah, so a drawing is just one event from this product space. So there is a second remark which I like to make. So in the next sections, in the next theorems, I talk about real valued IID random variables. And in my examples, and also here, yeah, the random variable were mapping to R, so they were one dimensional. So actually, we can easily generalize this to D dimensions. So this slide is just summarizing the product space. And let's now make the second remark about vectors of IID random variables. Okay. So if we have a sequence, say, of real valued one dimensional, yeah, so in R1 random variables, we can construct from these a sequence of D dimensional random variables. Y. Okay, so yk is a sequence. Every yk is a vector. So yk1 to ykd. And this should be a sequence of IID random variables with IID components. Okay, and maybe it's obvious how we do it. We just fill the vector element by element. Yeah? So this here is the jth component of yk, and yk is the kth element of the sequence. Okay, so that means if we have here a sequence of IID random variables, say xi. Okay, so now I have to draw some values. Yeah, so maybe the values are now just colors. Yeah, okay, so then we have orange, green, blue, gray. Okay, so then from that I construct the sequence yk. Say, for example, in two dimensions. So maybe I write that here on top. D is equal to 2. So then I would like to generate a sequence of vectors. And the vector is generated by taking the first element of the sequence x and placing it at the first element and the first component. The second goes in the first element, the second component, the third in the second element, first component, and so on. So we can populate this vector here. So that one goes there, and that one goes there. Okay, so and now I have a sequence of two-dimensional random variables. Okay, so why am I telling you this trivial stuff here? Because there is a small observation. Okay. So the generation of the sequence yk takes d times as long as the generation of XI for a fixed number of elements. That's trivial, yeah? So we need here in this example 2 times the values of X to generate the same amount of elements, because every element has two elements from X. Okay, but this means that this generation of a d-dimensional random sequence scales linear in the dimension. Okay, so, and actually this is a big deal here. This is good, yeah. It scales linear, because later we will see that many numerical methods scale exponential in the dimension. Yeah, think of integration. Yeah, if you like to integrate something and you discretize something in 2 dimension, yeah, you take in 1 dimension 10 dots. In 2 dimension, you have to take 10 times 10, which is 10 squared, yeah, and not 20, yeah, which would be 10 times 2. So actually the generation of a sequence in a higher dimension scales linear with the dimension, linear and not exponential. Okay, so just recapitulate 2 aspects. Our Monte Carlo method is about approximating an expectation using a random drawing. Drawing is actually why is scrolling? Sorry, I have a bug here. So where am I? Okay, so here. So drawing is actually corresponds to a sequence of IID random variables from which I take one event. So one event of a sequence of IID random variables. And with respect to sequences of IID random variables, there is this relation that we can create a d-dimensional sequence from a one-dimensional one. So the following stuff is a convergence result where I consider sequences of IID random variables. I just label them as real valued, but they could also be d-dimensional. Okay, so let's go to convergence results. So actually we like to prove somehow how our sum, our Monte Carlo sum, so actually we have a sequence xk, and we were looking at the sum xk, yeah? So how does this converge? Okay, and xk is was a drawing. So actually now I will look at sequences of IID random variables. So recall that our Monte Carlo sum is just one event applied to this sequence of IID random variables. So the first convergence result is the strong law of large numbers. Okay. So we have a sequence of IID, integrable, real valued random variables. Since it is integrable, we know that the expectation exists. Okay. Since they are identically distributed, they all have the same expectation. Okay. And since we had this prologue, you know that you can interpret this sequence of IID random variables as representing or modeling the drawing from a single random variable X. Okay, so actually this is exactly the situation which we discussed. And then we have that the limit of our Monte Carlo sum, so the limit of 1 divided by n, the sum over all xi, is equal to mu. So it converges to the expectation. So actually, this is exactly the theorem which we need. It tells us that taking just the running average over xi converges to the expectation, is now gives us an approximation of the expectation. In probability. So the small issue is that this only holds in probability. So the probability of this is 1. So this is maybe not nice. Okay, so actually this is a bit useless, this theorem for us. Because the fact that there is the probability actually says that it is possible that the convergence does not hold for some omega. Yeah. So in our example, this would be the omega tilde, yeah, the sample path for some omega. If this omega here is a null set. Okay. But then we couldn't maybe even generate omega. And another thing which is disappointing here is that this is just telling us something about the limit. It doesn't tell us anything about what's the situation if we stop at a certain n. So, and in the computer, we have to stop at a certain n. Okay, but it is at least telling us that this convergence. So there are generalizations of this theorem, and maybe this is nice to mention. So-called ergodic theorems, where you can actually relax some of the requirements. And in this context, our Monte Carlo sum, so the limit of the Monte Carlo sum so take the average of the sum of the xi here this is called time average. And the mu, so the expectation, so the expectation of x, yeah, so all the x are the same, have the same expectation. So actually, that is x of omega dp omega, or in a finite space, it is our sum x of omega p of omega. This is called space average. So in the time average, you average different random variables independent on a single event omega. And in the space average, you average a single random variable over all events. Okay. So, but the theorem, the strong law of large numbers, is not what we need. So we do not know how the convergence is, and actually what happens if we stop earlier. So the next one we could look at is the central limit theorem. Okay, and this also discusses a sequence of IID random variables, which we associate with a drawing. So now these guys should be square integrable. So we have knowledge not only about the expectation, but also about the variance. Okay, in that case, the probability that 1 divided by square root of n divided by sigma multiplied with the error, so the distance, xi to mu, the probability that this stays between a given bound converges to a value which is given by quantiles, actually the opposite of two quantiles, form the normal distribution function. So is given by capital phi of b minus capital phi of a, where capital phi is the cumulative normal distribution function. Maybe to get a better understanding here, let me rewrite this. Yeah. So if 1 divided by square root of n divided by sigma, the sum I from 1 to n xi minus mu should stay in this interval, then actually this is the same. Okay, I divide by 1 divided by square root of n, and I multiply with sigma. So then I have a times sigma divided by square root of n is smaller than, so now I have a 1 divided by n because I have two square roots here. The sum I from 1 to n xi minus mu, but having mu inside the sum gives me n times mu multiplied with this 1 divided by n gives me a minus mu outside of the sum. So minus mu. Okay. And on the right hand side also, so this is less or equal b times sigma divided by square root of n. Okay, so we can rewrite this guy inside the probability. And what does it mean? So I can start with some value b and a. For example, such that phi of b minus phi of a is, say, 99%. Okay, so it's a large number. So in order to have a large number on the right-hand side, B and A have to be far away in the normal distribution. Then it becomes larger on the right-hand side. Then this interval becomes bigger. The interval a times sigma divided by square root of n up to b times sigma becomes bigger. But okay, so I start with some value b and a. For example, such that phi of b minus phi of a is 99%. And then this tells me the probability that I stay inside this interval converges to these 99%. And the interval becomes smaller and smaller. You see, on the left-hand side, I have a times sigma divided by square root of n. And on the right-hand side, b times sigma divided by square root of n. The interval becomes smaller and smaller. And what's inside? Inside is the error. So it's the difference between my Monte Carlo approximation, so 1 divided by n, sum of xi, and the true expectation. Okay, so you could choose B and A such that you have a 99%. Then convergence tells you that there is some N such that this is, we are closer to this limit than say 1%. Yeah? So we are at 98%. And then you know that there is some N such that you are closer to this probability we like to achieve, yeah, than a given distance. And then you can choose the N which you like to have for the interval, and you take the larger of the two and have that with a certain given probability, you stay in a certain given interval, given that you are, that N is larger than a given point. Okay, that's already a nice result. So when we go back to our little picture, say, where was the picture here? Then this means that with a certain probability, we stay in some interval. Okay? And you see that here the interval is maybe larger. Okay, so this gives us already maybe a better understanding of the convergence. Okay, but still, this is just telling us that we are that we have convergence, but we do not have a convergence rate. So actually, we do not know at which point do we achieve a certain accuracy. So my criticism here is again that I have here the limit n to infinity, yeah, and I do not know what's happening if I have 1,000 sample points. And the second criticism is that it holds only in probability. Okay, so the same situation as before. We do not know the rate of convergence yet. Okay, so, but now a probabilistic error estimate and a probabilistic rate of convergence can be obtained with the Chebyshev inequality. So actually this is quite simple. And then we see what the convergence looks like. So recall the Chebyshev inequality. So I assume that X is square integrable. So we know the expectation of X and the variance of X. Yeah. So mu of X and the variance of X exist. Then we have for any epsilon greater than zero. So what's our interest is, what is the difference of a random variable and its expectation? So the probability that a random variable deviates from its expectation by more than epsilon is smaller than the variance of the random variable divided by epsilon squared. Actually here, it's not so clear what this has to do with our situation, because there's only one X. You don't see the sequence of IID random variables. We will come to this in a few minutes, yeah? But maybe first let's check this. Yeah? So if you like, we can just prove this. So assume the simple case that we know the density of X, that we know a density. So assume that X has a density and we know it. So this is phi. Okay, then let's start with the variance. So what's the variance of X? The variance of X, if I know the density, is the integral of omega, so little x, yeah, minus the expectation minus mu of X, so this is capital X, squared times the probability, so phi X dx. Okay, so that's the variance. Okay, then I can integrate over a smaller domain. So all the stuff I'm integrating here is larger than zero. Yeah, so the density is positive. Oh, larger equals zero, and this is also larger equals zero. So if I integrate over a smaller domain, whoops, then, so I take something out. What should I take out? Let's take out the set X minus E of X is smaller than epsilon. So let's remove this set. Yeah? So if I remove this set, then this integral becomes smaller. So in other words, the set which I use for integration is the set where X minus E of X is larger than epsilon, deviates from so X, little x, deviates from the expectation by more than epsilon. So then I make this integral even smaller if I plug in the smallest value for X minus expectation of X. So if I plug in epsilon. Yeah, so this guy here under the integral is now larger than epsilon if I include the square epsilon square. Okay, so I can make it even smaller, the integral even smaller, if I just take epsilon squared here. So I can move the epsilon squared in front of the integral. And what I'm integrating is just the density. So this is just the probability of the set. So this is just epsilon squared times the probability of X minus E of X being larger than epsilon. Okay, so now divide by epsilon and we have our Chebyshev inequality. So probability that X deviates from mu by more than epsilon is smaller than the variance of x. Divided by epsilon squared. Okay, so I copied this for you here in LaTeX. A little bit nicer. Yeah, it's small trivial proof. And how is this now helpful in our situation? Okay, so this gives us now the Monte Carlo convergence rate because I will replace the x with our Monte Carlo approximation, 1 divided by n, sum over xi, for a fixed n. Yeah? So for a fixed n, so I can now have an estimate for a fixed n. Okay. This remark just tells us that you can generalize the Chebyshev inequality. We can skip this. So the theorem, our Monte Carlo convergence rate. So given a sequence of iid real valued random variables, x1, x2, x3, and so on. So iid all have the same distribution. So I assume they are square integrable. So we know the expectation and we know the variance. Expectation is mu, variance is sigma squared. Then my Monte Carlo error. Yeah? So the distance of my Monte Carlo approximation from mu, the probability that this error is larger than epsilon is smaller than sigma squared divided by epsilon n. Okay, so why should I get this from the Chebyshev inequality? Let me copy this here. So the Chebyshev inequality was the probability that x minus mu is larger than epsilon is smaller than the variance of the random variable divided by epsilon squared. So now use the Chebyshev inequality with x being our Monte Carlo approximation, 1 divided by n, square root of sum from I from 1 to n, xi. Okay, so the expectation of x is mu because all the xi have the same mu. So what is the variance of x? Or maybe just copy the expectation of x. The expectation of x is 1 divided by n. So expectation is linear. So I know that this is just the sum of the expectations multiplied with 1 divided by n is just the expectation of xi. And what is the variance? So this would be our mu. So the variance. So if I have a linear scaling of a random variable, the variance is scaled with the square. So this 1 divided by n squared. And then if random variables are independent, the variance is summing up. The sum of independent random variables is the variance of xi. Okay, so let's call this here sigma squared. Yeah, so we have 1 divided by n squared, n times sigma squared. So it is sigma squared divided by n. So I get in the Chebyshev inequality the probability that my Monte Carlo error So the probability that my Monte Carlo approximation deviates from the true expectation, my Monte Carlo error, is larger than epsilon, is smaller or equal the variance sigma squared divided by n divided by epsilon squared. Okay, so, and that's what we have here. Sigma squared divided by epsilon squared n. Okay, so now you can use this in different forms. Yeah? So, for example, you can specify a certain allowed error, yeah? So epsilon, and then you can get a formula, the probability that you are outside of this epsilon is smaller than a given number. And this probability is becoming smaller and smaller the larger you choose n. So you can reduce the probability of falling outside your given error bound. So this version here is for a given epsilon, so error bound. By making n larger, we reduce the probability. Oops. What's that? So we reduce the probability of falling outside. Outside this error bound. Okay. Alternatively, we can set the right-hand side delta to being delta. So delta is equal to sigma squared divided by epsilon squared times n. So then if you solve this for epsilon, you have that epsilon is the square root of sigma squared divided by delta divided by n. So it is sigma divided by square root of delta times square root of n. And you can start using this by prescribing delta. And alternatively, you could also use the inverse here, the probability that our error is smaller than that okay is larger than so this is the opposite event, so it is 1 minus delta. Right? Yes. Okay. Okay, so you can specify some confidence level, say for example delta 95%. Yeah. The probability of being outside. No, delta should be a small number, say 5%. Yeah. So then the probability of staying outside should be below 5%. And for a given level of probability, by making n larger, you can make the interval smaller. Okay. So you make this here on the delta and you make here this bound smaller. Yeah. So you converge in some region. Yeah, so you converge in some region by making n larger. Okay, so let's write this here. So for a given delta, and this delta is now a confidence level. So the error should be in a certain interval with probability larger than 95%. By making n larger, we shrink the error bound. So it's just the opposite view. Okay, so we shrink the error bound. Okay, and maybe one important aspect here. How does this stuff converge? So it converges by square root of n. Okay. So maybe I take a different color here. Yeah. So the convergence rate. Is say 1 divided by square root of n. Okay, so Chebyshev inequality gave us this Monte Carlo convergence rate. So now we know that we have convergence with a certain rate. And also, like in other results, nice is that we also know the coefficient in front of the convergence rate. It's sigma. Yeah. So sigma is the variance of the random variable. Okay, so this is a very nice convergence estimate. It's a square root of n. Where does the square root of n come from? Okay, so actually it came here from this part. Yeah, so Chebyshev inequality is expressing it as the variance. Okay. And then we had here epsilon and here epsilon squared. Yeah. So this epsilon squared came from that we were deriving Chebyshev inequality using the variance. Okay. And then by inverting, we get, instead of the square, we get square root. Okay, what is maybe not so nice here is now we have to go back, yeah, so, and we are almost finished now, that we have now a convergence rate. We know it is 1 divided by square root of n, but it's only with a certain probability. And when I discussed the other convergence result, okay, we had that we have convergence almost surely. And I see you also had this question, okay, why should we care about a null set? So we have convergence on almost surely, yeah. But we did not know the convergence rate. And here, to know the convergence rate, we have to pay the price that we have a worse convergent. So we might have a different rate on a set with some probability. Okay, so and this is now actually a bad situation. If you recall that in the beginning, I was discussing that actually a drawing from a random variable is one event, is one omega of this sequence of IID random variables. So when you have this P here in front, probability, actually now that we have just a single experiment, yeah, a single path, might be a problem. Okay, so we got quite far, yeah, but still it smells a little bit suspicious that everything only holds in probability and we are actually doing one sample path. So to conclude, so this was now the remark which I just made. So note that while a classical convergence estimate, this estimate holds only in a certain probability. Yeah? So this looks like an issue. So we will come back to this later, where I have a nice example showing you that actually this probabilistic nature is creating a certain advantage, maybe also with respect to this cursive dimension. Yeah? And also later we will see some methods that get rid of this. Okay, so that was it for today. Yeah. So the next thing is Monte Carlo integration. So we can use this approximation for an expectation to actually calculate integrals. So what you just saw is an integration method.